We are in the middle of a series that's kind of in between series. You know what I mean? We're kind of in that awkward transition phase where we came out of our series in Genesis to start the new year. But then there's a lot of transition because we've got summer camp. That's one way. We got winter camp coming up in Costa Rica. So we said, well, what can we do kind of like as a filler for a few weeks that would be really productive and beneficial for you guys as students? And so we have been doing what we call like our mail call series or question series. It doesn't really have a name. But it's essentially just saying, what if there was no holds barred and just whatever you wanted to ask about Christianity, social, anything, you could ask it all and we would answer it from a biblical perspective or biblical worldview. It could be about apologetics. It could be a doubt you have about God. It could be anything. So that number's up there on the screen if you want to ask it anonymously. I have the hiccups. We also have some of those already have been written out and put it here into the box of truth and questions. Or if you're sitting here going, no, I have a question about this right now, you can raise your hand and ask at any point. That's not a problem. So feel free to do that. Or if it's about you but you don't want to ask it in the first person, just be like, I'm asking for a friend. And my friend thinks, that's totally fine. We'll all go, oh, your friend. Okay, cool. This morning, we talked about Mormonism. We talked about, the question was Mormonism this morning, and we spent our actual whole time talking about Mormonism, the difference between Mormonism and Christianity. Last night we talked about dinosaurs. And so there's a lot of stuff we've covered. So some of that I think will be beneficial, but I am going to either go to the box of questions unless you go, no, I really want to talk about that thing. All right, box of questions it is. Do Catholics go to heaven even though they pray to saints and confess sin to priests? Are these major or minor differences? Okay, so stop. Everyone stop. Almost everything that we talk about when it comes to asking difficult questions is that there's, most of the time when we have a problem with something, there's some kind of a mistake in even the question asking, okay? Here's what we'll say as far as this goes. We, as Christians, we would adhere to what we call the four solas. Okay, we talked about these last week. Yes? In this service? That's what's hard because I don't know what service we do what in. Because we do different ones every service. Sola Scriptura, Sola Fide, Sola Christus, and Sola Gratia, which means we are saved. Those are Latin terms, but it makes up the bedrock of the Christian faith. We are saved by grace alone, which means you can't be saved by works. There's not amount of stuff you can do to be saved. You can't make yourself righteous or right with God because you do a certain amount of things or because you don't smoke pot. That's not what makes somebody a Christian. It's not what saves you, okay? There are lifelong pot smokers and not, well, pot's actually legal now, but there's lifelong cocaine. That's still illegal, right? Good, and I'm not going to tell you anything what I'm doing this weekend. So there's people that do cocaine until the day that they die. That will be in heaven. There's people that have murdered that will be in heaven. There's people that's it's a non sequitur, okay? What you do is a non sequitur to the faith that you have. Now, what scripture would say is that your faith is going to change the way that you act, okay? It just does that naturally, okay? We talked about that love. When you experience a love like that and a grace like that, the way that you act towards people ought to be different, which is why this world is in such a disarray, I think, when it comes to Christians, is some Christians don't have that actual saving grace faith. But they love to implement rules on people who didn't adhere to the same rule book, right? Like, oh, I'm a Christian, therefore it says that Christians shouldn't they should only speak when it's edifying towards people. And so when you ever hear someone doing something opposite, you think that it's your job as a Christian to rectify the situation, but it's not. Okay, when it comes to any part of social justice, the Christian's job is not to make everyone Christian, okay, in a political sense. If someone acts like a Christian without knowing Jesus, it's like spraying cologne. It doesn't make a difference. It's just, it's still not what the goal would be. The goal would be, ultimately, that they would come to know Christ. We want the change of heart to be out of knowing Christ. Okay, so if you're, that's the goal. But Christians have done a terrible job of this. We think, since Christians believe this, everyone needs to believe what I believe. Okay, and that's what God wants. God wants everyone to think like a Christian, act like a Christian. No, God wants everyone to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. Okay, so don't get that twisted. So the way that we vote and everything is independent of some of that stuff. Here's what I mean by that. If you think that since God calls Christians to, let's say, not engage in homosexual practices, then automatically then no one else is allowed to either. Okay, if you're going to make an argument on that based on social issues, that's fine. Then you can try to do that. But don't take your cross to the polling booth and go, since God said no, no one can. Well, in Scripture says very clearly, Christian, the Bible is for Christians, not for non-Christians. We're playing different sports, okay? So like a Christian, think about the Super Bowl today. Imagine if a basketball referee would be a Christian in this situation. The Christian walks into the football field like, traveling, unnecessary roughness, foul, two shots. Everyone thinks that person is a psycho. That's correct. Idiot is their correct phrase. You don't look any different when you do this. When you walk in like, hey, you guys Christians? No. Oh, well then, in the Bible, it says this about homosexuality. They didn't sign up for that game. Stop calling foul on stuff they didn't sign up for. They're not playing. Okay? You can love them independently of those different things, but they're not playing the same game. Okay? So stop. You're bugging the world. Okay? And you're killing our influence in the world because you keep walking around trying to impose different rules on people who don't want to play the game. Okay? If you call yourself a Christian, then God says, here's my set of rules, and here's how you can live life to the full, and we should be pushing each other towards that. But if you're not, friggin' leave them alone. Okay? Just leave them alone. Capiche? Good. Glad we talked about that. Which has nothing to do with the answer to the question. A little bit of a tangent. When we talk about the solas, though, we talk about sola gratia. It's not by works, okay? So Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, not of yourselves, not by works, so that no man can boast. For you are Christ's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works. In other words, God gave us a free gift, not something that we earned, okay? Because of that, it is by grace you have been saved through faith. So it was a free gift, but it wasn't given because you're tall, short, cute, smart, black, white, Indian. Doesn't make a difference. The reason that you were given the gift that was free was because you believed that the gift was free. That's what by grace through faith means. The grace part is free gift. By faith means you accepted it, not because of any part of your own. Okay? By grace through faith in Christ, meaning that God became man, fully God and fully man. We believe in the perfect divinity of Christ here on this planet. He did not sin. He took the sin of all of us to the cross. And when he was crucified, being a perfect man, perfect people deserve to live forever and never die. So if a perfect man died, what is owed to him is the eternal life that was taken away from him. So when a perfect man deserves eternal life and that was stripped from him, the trade-off he made was imperfect people deserve to die. So the trade God made on the cross was, since I'm perfect and I deserve eternal life and that was taken from me when I was killed, I now can hold that and hand that out and go, this is what I'm owed is eternal life. Do you want a part of it? Here's all I have to say. Just say and believe that when I died on that cross, your sin was paid for too. That's the whole Christian belief system. Not because of what you've done or how tall you are because you don't smoke pot. It's that. That's it. That's the be all and end all. Do you believe that when Jesus Christ died on the cross 2,000 years ago, that your sin was nailed to that cross too? Then you're saved. Oh, happy day. That's it. Which is sola Christus, through Christ alone. Okay? There's no other prophets. There's no other divine revelation outside of Christ and his word. Okay, John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. That word in there is capitalized. It means Jesus. Okay, Jesus was with God at the beginning of time. He wasn't created. He wasn't made. He is eternal, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made. Very God of very, very God. Okay, that's the Nicene Creed part of it. And the last part is sola scriptura, which means we only have one divine revelation, which means any other book can't tell us what God, who God is, what God thinks, all that other stuff. Only the Bible itself. That Bible is comprised because of different councils that were brought together to comprise the 66 books that we now know as Scripture. They all go through a rigorous test of authenticity, historicity, facts, outside sources, early Christian scholarship. There's a crazy rigorous test to become text of Scripture. Very, very rigorous. We believe that 66 books have made that in, and there are no other books that made it in, nor are there people today or in history, except for the time of the apostles, that can speak on behalf of God, and they had to have been in contact with God personally. No one wrote a book of Scripture that did not talk to Jesus or was spoken to God himself. These aren't someone's feelings. Paul, on the road to Damascus, sees Jesus face to face after Jesus comes back from the dead, and he speaks to him, and he gives him this divine revelation. All throughout the Old Testament, the book of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, all written by Moses, a prophet of God. Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 Samuel, 1 Kings, 1 Chronicles, Ezra, Esther, Job, Psalm, Ecclesiastes, Isaiah. The whole thing was because they've interacted with God. David in the Psalms, in the poetic series, Solomon, all these people, all the prophets then, beginning Jeremiah, or Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Obadiah, Jeremiah, Nehemiah, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians. All these people interacted with God personally. It is because of that that they can write Bible. So we believe if you have interacted with God personally, and he didn't speak to you through this rigorous test and process, then you may not speak divine truth. Okay? So anyone who walks in like, God told me this, and this is in contradiction to the Bible, but now listen to me, we go, you are a heretic. For Hebrews says, Jesus Christ was the final revelation. Okay? There's the Bible is sufficient in and of itself. Nothing else is needed other than the Scriptures as far as salvation goes. Okay? So, we do this test and you bring Catholicism into the picture. Now, there is a stark, remarkable difference between Roman Catholicism, as it were originally penned, and modern, mostly cultural Catholicism. Okay? Just so you guys can understand that. And it's not unlike Christianity or unlike Mormonism for that sense. Okay? There's Christian churches that say that God's goal is for everyone to be happy, to live a wealth and abundant life. And if you walk in that church, you'd be like, Jesus wants me to be happy and to have an abundant life? Oh, that's fantastic. He wants me to have money and he wants me to be healthy. And you start to believe that and you go, well, that's what a Christian is, isn't it? But then when you go back to the actual text, you go, the promises he made were like, in this world you will have trouble. Or follow me and people are going to hate you. Or there's going to be divisions amongst all of you. But take heart, for I've overcome the world. You're going to undergo trial, but you're going to be pressed, but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed, because you've been blessed beyond the curse. For his promise will endure, that is joy is going to be my strength. That's the promise of Scripture. Not that your life's going to suck. That's what Scripture says. It's going to blow, especially if you're following Jesus, because you can't just do whatever you want whenever you want. But we actually find that life doesn't lead to full abundance. When it comes to Catholicism, the early Roman understanding of it, the original split around the time of Columbus, when Martin Luther posted the 95 Theses to the church door at Wittenberg to start a debate with the Catholic Church about what they're doing and some of the stuff that they're doing, including the selling of indulgences for the forgiveness of sins by a guy named John Tetzel. This was the power and primacy of the Pope. Papal primacy is what we would talk about. That the Pope at the time was saying, yes, you have to pay for forgiveness. Well, Martin Luther, very few people had access to Scripture at that point, but a monk named Martin Luther is reading through Romans 1, verse 16, Romans 5, 8, Romans 10, 9, and he goes, what? You have to pay for forgiveness? It's a free gift. That's what Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 says. It says that you have no power in and of yourself. You were dead. What are you talking about? You can earn it. You can't earn anything. Since then, a lot of those different doctrines in Catholicism have been redacted. And even later popes have kind of apologized for other things that other popes have said. To a point now where Pope almost maintains a figurehead, not unlike the king in England for a lot of Catholics. Some Catholics still are this devout, like, kiss the ring kind of Catholic kind of thing. But a lot of people are kind of like, yeah, he's neat. He's fantastic. He lives in Vatican City. There's great tradition involved with that thing. But they wouldn't believe that the Pope could stand up and change Scripture. A lot of Catholics would go, excuse me, what? When you look at the original doctrine, the Pope has the power to do that. The Pope, believing to be from the lineage of Peter, originally, when Jesus is at Caesarea Philippi in the New Testament, he says, who do you say that I am? The person who responds is a guy by the name of?
Peter.
Peter says, you are the Messiah, the Son of God. Jesus' response is, from now on, Peter, you're going to be called Peter. His name was Simon before, Simon Peter. But now he says, but from now on, everyone's going to know you as Petros, the rock. And on this rock, I will build my church. And the gates of hell will not be able to endure against it. So the Christian belief system is when they said, on this rock, I will build my church. The rock is the foundational truth that Jesus is the Messiah. That is the truth that has withstood for thousands and thousands of years. whether the Catholic Church or the line of Peter remains. But then Catholics would say when that promise was made, it was made that Peter and his lineage, that's what would never be destroyed. So they said, okay, so Peter and his the group that followed him and the people, his quote-unquote disciples per se, those people began the papacy. So when Jesus said, I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom, Peter, and the gates of hell will not stand against you, Catholics believe that that was actually a promise for Peter, not for the church and that truth. So Christians and Protestants will go, no, no, that promise was that Jesus Christ is always going to be known as Messiah. And Catholics go, no, no, no. The promise was that Peter is going to hold the keys to the kingdom. Keys to the kingdom meaning that whatever Peter looses on earth, it'll be loosed in heaven. Whatever he binds on earth will be bound in heaven. In other words, Peter would have the ability to change that. Well, Christians say that's not true. That's where there'd be a difference between Christians and Catholics, is Christians would believe fundamentally that no one has the ability to change Scripture, to interpret it differently. So sola scriptura would be a place where we'd have a little bit of a disagreement. The question is about hell. Would they go to hell? And I think that is a stretch and a half. Why? Because Romans 10, 9 to 10. If you believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and confess with your mouth that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Now, the Jesus is Lord part, if you take fundamental Roman Catholicism in the way that it was originally intended, saying that people can be saved by doing a certain number of things through works righteousness, these are things you must do to be saved, you've then taken the grace and the faith out of Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. Can you then, on your own behest, on your own behalf, on your own merit, make a case that you can get to heaven because of your own works? That's where you'd get really dangerous. But most Catholics, a lot of Catholics, to this day would say, no, no, no. It is by grace we have been saved through faith, not of yourselves, not by works, so no man can boast. But you have to understand the original Catholic doctrine didn't say that. The original Catholic doctrine did say, you must do this certain number of things to earn the grace of God. It's called semi-Pelagianism, which means God sent his son, and then we have to meet him halfway, and then we're saved. But the message of Scripture is, we were dead. Dead people don't move towards God. They just be dead, okay? And God moved all the way and ripped us out of the grip of death and brought us into eternal life. That's a Christian worldview. A lot of Catholics have a current Christian worldview, but they're culturally Catholic. When you go, what is cultural Catholicism? What does cultural Catholicism mean? It's like cultural Judaism. Okay, you got a lot of guys who believe in Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior who wear a yarmulke, because Catholicism has kind of become a lot like Judaism, where you have a belief system with Judaism, but you also have a people that live in Jerusalem who are Jewish. It's kind of what Catholic has become. It was so fundamental to people groups, a lot of different Hispanic cultural groups, a lot of Irish groups. It's more of like what you do. Like you can get this guy who's drunk in a bar, like, F the world, I don't even know anything else about it. Thank God and Mary. And you're like, what did you say? What the? God and Mary. And then you're drunk and you just killed that guy and you want to fight him. Like, what are you talking about? Right? And so they're like kissing their cross before they, like Boondock Saints, like, and they kill everyone in the room. Have you ever seen that movie?
Yeah.
It's fantastic. So there's a cultural aspect of things where you kind of give your nod to God every once in a while. Like, yeah, cool. We're kosher. But then there's also this idea of, no, we follow this as a belief system. And a lot of that is where you kind of have to wade through and navigate the gray. So any moron who stands up and goes, all Catholics are going to hell, is probably going to hell, okay? Because that's just, it's false. Because there's no way that you can broad stroke that. That's like saying, are all Christians going to heaven? Well, what's a Christian? There's your real question. Are all Jesus followers going to heaven who have submitted their lives to him? Yes. Are all Christians? What the frick is a Christian? You check a box on your Facebook, Christian. You mark it on your Scantron for your SATs, Christian. That doesn't mean squat. It doesn't mean anything. In the name of Christianity, I've seen people burn other people. I haven't seen it. I've read books. I wasn't there standing idly by like, this sucks. Right? But like Westboro Baptist Church, you're like, oh, we're Christian. No, you're not. You're Christian like I'm vegan. Not at all, okay? If God wanted us to be vegetarian, he would have never made pigs out of bacon. That's what I think about things. Can I get a witness? Can I get a witness? This is the most energetic I've ever seen this room of people. It's about time we got some Southern Baptist in here. Bunch of white people in a room. Yep. Every once in a while, can I just get like, That's why I like, where's Maddie Coleman? Maddie Coleman's my resident, I'm like at the pinnacle of the most impressive and like earth-shattering, Holy Spirit-moving sermon of my life, and white people are like, Afterwards, like, my life was changed. I'm all, I thought you were sleeping. Why? They look very similar. Come on. I heard a come on. Okay, good for you. Was that, are you Carson Sass? You know what? That's where I expected to come from, someone like you. In touch with your inner Southern Baptist. Fantastic. Okay. Does that answer the question on Catholicism? Just, guys, the Bible is, it's full of tensions that we're supposed to manage. And we as human beings are so lazy that we want to let go of tensions a lot, right? Like, is God, is he just or is he loving? Yes. You hold this side of love, you hold this side of justice, and pull as hard as you can. You go, well, let's resolve it. If you resolve that tension, you've missed God. If you resolve the tensions of Scripture, you're going to miss out on who God is. It's not meant to be resolved. Is he a fierce lion who can take down nations and will come with a powerful sword? Yes. Is he a lamb who was caught in the thicket, who was slain on our behalf, who, like a sheep before his shearers, is silent, didn't say a word when he was accused of blasphemy? Yes. Did he speak strongly against the Pharisees and the religious elite who were the most powerful in the world at that time? Or did he love on the destitute, prostitute, and marginalized? Yes. Don't manage that tension, though. You rest in the middle of it. He's not supposed to be figured out, okay? That's that tension. So when someone walks up like, well, Catholics are this, and the Catholics are not this, it's like, how, that's so debased. That's racism, but it's religiousism. Because calling yourself something on a spectrum of which there are people who murder in the name of it and those who save millions of lives in the name of it and everything in between, to broad paintbrush something is just, it's irresponsible as a human being. So the question you need to ask when you get to those conversations with people who are Catholic is, what do you believe concerning Jesus? What about grace? What about faith? What about Scripture? Does the Pope have the ability to overthrow what Scripture says? These are the important questions. My guess would be, with the amount of Catholics that I've interacted with, the answer to almost all those questions have Christian answers, but they're culturally Catholic. Can someone be culturally Catholic and a Christian and go to heaven? Yeah, absolutely. Are you kidding me? 100%. Okay? Yeah.
Can the Pope just write whatever he wants, like, into the Bible?
Yes. But no. Yes, in terms of, it's like one of the original doctrines where they kind of go, don't look at that one, don't look at that, don't look at that. So there would be a really hard time affirming it, but when you actually look at the original mandates, you'd go, there is validity to be able to do that. So don't go like, well, I don't think so. It doesn't matter what you think. You have to go read the original documents. You have to go back and read the different councils that established the Catholic Church. Okay? So if you think, oh, he's hating on the Catholic Church. No, I'm not. Do you know what the freaking Christians did called the Crusades? There's a lot of stuff that we do that we're like, ooh, ignore that part of our history. Ooh, geez. Right? Do you know how many Christian pastors commit adultery every year? Chris Brown is part of a group called the K Club. It's the people in Southern California whose church has over 1,000 people coming to it every weekend. He said in the last 8 years, the turnover in that group of 50 or 60 people has been all but 10. So don't ever stand on a moral high horse when it comes to this. There are no perfect Christians. We're all in rehab in one area or another. And no one in rehab looks at the other guy in rehab next to them and makes fun of them. You just don't. You're like, oh my gosh, you have a problem with coke. You're so dumb. You've got an issue. It's like if you're in prison, you're like, you're an idiot. You're on the top. Look, you're in a jail cell. He's like, you're in a jail cell too. Yeah, but I know, but you're like really in a jail cell. It's like you're both. Without Jesus, we're all screwed. So like don't ever look down on other people when it comes to those kind of things or their histories or something, because Christians don't have a lot of leg to stand on when it comes to that kind of stuff. Just for the record. So don't be like, well, Catholics used to. I can go, well, Christians used to. Christians still do. It's about being a follower of Jesus, not adhering to a religious institution. We're Jesus followers. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. The Eucharist?
Yeah.
So is it actually the bottom, or the Eucharist and the wine, is it actually the body and blood of Jesus, or is it more of a symbol?
Okay, so that's a good question. So I'm going to use words and then I'm never going to use them again. One is transubstantiation is what you're talking about. There's consubstantiation. There's symbolic presence. There's Zwinglianism. So you're asking the...
Well, transubstantiation, they believe that through that, that's when the body actually goes through.
Yeah. So we would use the phrase, the accidents turn. So what that means is some of the original Catholic belief was that the bread and the wine on undergoing the words of invocation... in the Latin, it was hocus corpus meum, which is here is my body, which is actually a really cool phrase. But this is just a fun fact. Kids used to listen to that. The priest would get up in front of the church and he would bless the body. Because I think this is actually a good practice to do. We did it when I was Lutheran growing up. We believe in what's called consubstantiation, not transubstantiation, but blah, 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 blah. Big words. But basically, the table is set. Jesus, on the night which he betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke and gave to the disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this often, you drink it in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the meal, he took the cup of the new covenant and said, I will not drink this until I drink it again in the presence of my Father. Therefore, do this as often as you drink it together in remembrance of me. So he basically says, guys, I want you to participate in what I call communion. Basically, I want you guys, don't forget to meet together and to participate in this meal to remember what happened. That's what is phrased in that night. Do this as often as you drink of it together in remembrance of me. Now, the different beliefs on that are what we call transubstantiation, is that when the priest gets up and says, when Jesus says, this is my body, that it literally becomes his body. Okay, so one of the original ideas was if you take that bread and you take a bite out of it, you're like biting Jesus. Again, don't walk up to every Catholic and go, well, this is what you think. Don't do that. Don't be a moron. Okay? But the original belief was, like my teacher, Mrs. Kelleher, when I was in elementary school, she was taught that if you bit into it, the blood of Jesus would come out. So you just have to let it sit in your mouth, and then it will slowly dissolve, things like that. Okay, so that's called transubstantiation. Lutherans believe what's called consubstantiation, which means that the body or the bread and the wine are still bread and wine, but Jesus is the remembrance of Jesus and Jesus' presence is in, with, and under that. And it can bring affirmation, and it can bring reconciliation, and it's a meal that's supposed to be used to bring reconciliation between the body of Christ. It says don't approach God's table with vengeance on anyone, so you want to go make forgiveness. And then that body, that meal is supposed to represent and be this way that we can receive forgiveness. So the Lutheran view is that it actually brings about forgiveness, just like confessing your sins and being absolved, someone saying that you're forgiven. The non-denominational view is symbolic presence, which says that we do it as a memory, just like we would, what is other junk we do as a memory? What do you do that? Yeah, that's not it. I don't really know what it is. What do we pretend? Like the manger scene. You don't really know a lot of people who are like, he's there. That baby in there, he's there. So that's what the non-denominational view would be, which includes Evangelical Free Church Association, which North Coast is a part of. North Coast, the EV Free is basically the body of Christ that goes, whatevs. I don't know. EV Free Church, which is what North Coast Church is, basically says, if there's intelligent Christ-believing Bible-believing Christians on this side of a debate and on this side of a debate, then do either one. We don't care. If the Bible, if it's not a red light or a green light issue in the Bible, but it's a yellow light issue, then whatever. So you go and take it as a symbolic presence and you're going to go take it as being his physical presence? Okay. Whatever. I would personally probably come from more of what you would call consubstantiation, which is where I would kind of adhere more to, where I believe that it's bigger than, oh, this is kind of fun to remember. It has the ability to bring reconciliation. Not that it's necessary for forgiveness or necessary for salvation, but it's much bigger. It's called a sacrament. Okay, you guys, we don't use that word a lot at church here at North Coast Church. Okay. I just explained all of them. What specifically do you want to know about the Eucharist?
Well,
I just explained them. But what was your real question about the Eucharist?
We went to Catholic school.
Yay!
For a long time.
Me
so
too.
That's why she's like.
Yeah, yeah.
So we all learned about like the transubstantiation.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just confused on whether like I'm just believing it's like actually him when that we're like taking it, or if it's more of like a symbol of like.
Yeah. Yeah. This is one that we would call like an open-handed issue where there's going to be people on every side of it. And I always want to teach you guys in here always how to think, not what to think on this issue. On an issue that, again, I think there's validity on each and every one of these things, then I would go, maybe doesn't matter that much. The fact that when you do bite into bread, even after it's been invoked and the words of institution have been spoken over them, that blood doesn't have to come out, I would go, okay, well, we can actually do a test on that one where we know that this still tastes like wine and that still tastes like bread, and we know that human flesh tastes of chicken. That's what cannibals say. no one asked, but there's a fun fact for your day. So I would go, yeah, it actually changing, that's one of the only ones that you can actually do a test on and go, okay, you can say that it comes out, but people have surely in the history of the Catholic Church bitten into it, even accidentally, and gone, there's a lack of blood here. So I would go, I would hear more towards the second two, but I think someone who goes, no, I think this is actually it, it's not like a salvation issue thing, anything. Fun fact, that Latin phrase, horcus copus meum, which is, this is my body, whenever the priest would hand out bread to everyone, he would say, hocus corpus meum, hocus pur, because they would speak in Latin, because that's the least confusing way to give a sermon, right, is in Latin, to people who, in a dead language. But he would do it over, but the kids thought, they would ask their mom, like, why is he saying that? And they'd say, it's the words of institution, it changes the bread into the body of Christ. So they started adopting it when they were doing their magic tricks. And they would start saying, hocus pocus. Hocus pocus. It's hocus corpus meum, but they would go, hocus pocus, because the priest would do it to change things so that they would do it now to change things too. Hocus pocus. Wow. I'm here for you. That's why I'm here. I'm here. You're out getting the car. What'd you learn today at church? I gave 40 minutes on this beautiful exegesis of the Eucharist, and you're like, did you know hocus pocus? Freaking talked about like this huge expanse of Catholicism and the Eucharist, and you're going to be like, hocus pocus, that's neat. Should be in our review video. That's how we learn. Yes, miss, hold on. Let me make sure we have time to ask a question. Yes, we have 3 minutes.
The extra books in the Catholic Bible, I was in Bible study.
Yeah.
And she used that, still used that Bible.
Yeah.
So they're not real Bible. I don't know.
Right. So they wouldn't, here's what we would say about that. We would say those should be given validity, not unlike a textbook would be. There's a lack of God in them insofar as like the story of the Maccabean Revolt, the institution of the religious figure and the eagle over the temple. If you read all those books, there's a group of books that the Catholics put in their Bible that kind of tell the history of the pre-diaspora in the years of silence, the 400 years of silence between the Old Testament and New Testament, and the Catholic Bible is going to fill in that gap with these stories, but they don't push or give revelation towards who Jesus is, who God is. It's more telling a history. So we think there's room for it, but it doesn't have any implication on salvation or on the property or anything of Jesus. So we would, the properties of Jesus. So we would say, yeah, if you want to study those as an outside source, cool. They're not like the Gnostic Gospels, which are a false telling of events, like the Gospel of Peter, 125 AD. We talked about that last week, right, in this sermon. So it's not like that where it's false. It's just something that we'd go, yeah, we just don't put those in as. Yeah, it's not even false. It's not false. It's just, it's like if Josephus writes. Josephus is a historian at that time, and he wrote stuff, but there was not, he wasn't trying to tell you something about Jesus. So that's what John says. He goes, if we wrote everything about this period of time, there wouldn't be enough books in all the libraries in the universe to fill it all. So I have come to tell you this, which is sufficient for your eternal life. So as that text goes, one of the tests for validity of Scripture is, does it reveal to us something about God? Okay. Esther, in the Old Testament, barely made it because of that. How many times is God mentioned in Esther?
Zero
times. But since it connects the same story of God's prophecy of going through this lineage, they keep it in there. Okay? So that's the difference. That's a great question, though. Yes, you have 1 minute. This better be a fast question.
You said Gnostic gospel?
Gnostic comes from the word kenosis, which means to know something. There's a group of gospels that were found after the Gospel of Thomas, Gospel of Mary Magdalene, Gospel of Peter, that claim to have knowledge of Jesus but don't actually. So we call them Gnostic gospels. It's kind of a satirical way of calling something something. Like, oh, the knowledge gospels. It's actually our way of saying they're false. 1 minute question. See if I can find a 1 minute question right here. Did God or Jesus ever have sex? No. God the Father doesn't and never had a physical body. Therefore, he doesn't have sexual organs. He is given the properties of being male insofar as the royal understood male figure. We say he or father. That's what he's given to us. But he does not have a gender insofar as he relates to us as dudes, or he doesn't relate to us as women. He relates to both equally because he, not that he's androgynous insofar as he's called himself father, but he doesn't have sexual organs. He is spirit. He is being. Jesus, if he did have sex, we have no record of it. But we do know that it says that he was tempted in every way that man was and yet was found to be without fault. We would then reiterate that Peter or Paul in the New Testament says that the man is more equipped if he doesn't take a wife because his allegiance is only to God and not to anybody else. He then goes on to affirm and saying, but if you want to get married, freaking get married. It can really affirm you. But as anyone in ministry will ever tell you, when you get married, your ministry is not as effective as it was before. It just can't be. I'll tell you this from someone who got married and had kids. My ministry gets weaker and weaker every time I have a new baby, right? Because your attention is divided more. And I'm not like God who can divide his love equally without it ever diminishing. His is always multiplied. Mine's divided. My time's divided. My everything else is divided. So we would say that Jesus never had those interactions. And since he was never married, he would never have had sex, because to have sex without marriage would have been that he would have sinned, and we know that he was perfect. So no, he didn't. Let me pray for us. Hey, God, thanks for everything. We apologize as your body and as your representation to the world in those areas where we take really strong stands one way or the other that get us into trouble. Not standing on your truth, God, but standing in those areas that have been made unclear. And we start to compartmentalize whole groups of people by certain accusations, the same ones that we don't want to be accused of. May we, in humility, understand that the complexity of you, the tensions that you hold in Scripture are not meant to be relieved, they're meant to be managed. May we be your people of love, and may we be people of understanding, but may we always be based on truth and never sway from that. Let me pray. Amen.